Strongsville United Church of Christ online worship for Sunday, January 17th, 2021, the second Sunday after Epiphany. We're so happy that you've come and joined us wherever you are, whatever time it is. Just a couple of announcements. And the first is I would like to thank Richard Densmore for coming in and recording his organ music. We're so glad that he is here virtually with us, and we're so glad that Mike and Tom are here with their music, a little bit different this week. I know you'll enjoy it. Also, we have already 36 jars of peanut butter, all sizes, all brands, all varieties, crunchy and creamy, are welcome. We are collecting those for the Strongsville Emergency Food Bank through the month of January, so we still have a couple of weeks to drop those off at the church between 9 and 4, Monday through Friday. We are also going to be doing a Penny Sunday, and it will actually be on a Sunday, January 31st, between 10 and noon. We will have our bucket out, and you can drive through and collect, and we might be snapping a picture of you, too. If you can't make it at that time, you can come anytime in the week thereafter and drop off your coins, your nickels, dimes, pennies, quarters, dollar bills, $5 bills, C notes, checks, whatever you got, we'll take them between 9 and 4, Monday through Friday. And the last announcement I have is that the thrift shop will have their grand reopening. They have a new floor plan, new displays, new merchandise, and that will be open from 10 until 4 on Thursday the 21st. Of January. So we hope that you will get some bargains and join us to see all the work that Kathy and her team have done in the thrift shop. Does anyone else have any announcements this morning, evening, or afternoon? Seeing none, we'll continue with our worship.
Most glorious, the
excerpts from Psalm 139, the New International Version. You have searched me, Lord, and you know me. You know when I sit and when I rise. You perceive my thoughts from afar. You discern my going out and my lying down. You are familiar with my ways. Where can I go from your spirit? Where can I flee from your presence? If I go up to the heavens, you are there. If I make my bed in the depths, you are there. If I rise on the wings of the dawn, if I settle on the far side of the sea, even there your hand will guide me. Your right hand will hold me fast. If I say, surely the darkness will hide me and the light become night around me, even the darkness will not be dark to you. The night will shine like the day, for darkness is as light to you.
Thank you, Irene. Again, we take time as we go to a time of prayer to light the candle for our first responders. The vaccines are coming. They're making their way, slowly but surely, first to those that need them most, those that are protecting us from the virus in their everyday work that they do. As you go to a time of prayer, I also invite you to continue to keep our nation in prayer as we continue through this period of transition. It's interesting times, and we will get through as a church, as a nation, and as the world. Let's pray together. Holy One, we come seeking your presence. Wherever we are, we know you are already here. Help us in this time to rest in your presence and to speak to you the names and situations that are ever so dear to our hearts in a time of silence. As a mother comforts her child, O Lord, your Holy Spirit visits us, comforts us, soothes our aching, tired spirits, reminds us that you are still moving among us, you are still speaking, and you are still calling prophets into the world to speak of your love and your future in this world, of your kingdom, not ours. God, we are grateful for the time when you already came in physical form and dwelt among us, showing us that indeed humans are worth your time and effort. We are grateful that Jesus came and taught us to pray together, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts, as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen.
Thank you.
doing holding a piece of crumbly brown paper. Well, today's passage that we're going to hear in a little bit talks about Samuel, who was just a young boy when God called him. And he didn't know quite what he was listening for. So I thought this morning I'd ask what you think God calling you might sound like. And I had some interesting thoughts of what might be a call from God. And one of them is, what would you think if you heard something like this? Would that make you think of God at all? Maybe. Maybe this is the wrapping that comes off something and there's a gift inside. We just came through Christmas when we received the greatest gift of all. I've asked my grown-up friends to help me with some noises. Irene, you want to do your noise first? Ooh, what does that sound like? I put all the noises together so I know what they are. That's some beads in a little Tupperware. And maybe it would make you think of things that you can make, because God made all things, and with beads you could make something special. Chuck, what you got? Ooh. I wish you could have the visual that went with Chuck shaking a tambourine. You know, tambourines are used a lot when people dance. And so if God is celebrating, if we are celebrating at the temple, as Jews were known to do before Jesus' time and in Jesus' time, maybe there were tambourines. And then one last thing, what you got, Tom? Ooh. That's a maraca. And that may make you think of something else, maybe a snake. And that doesn't exactly make us think of God, does it? But God makes all things new and works all things for God's good purpose. So even the snake at some point becomes useful for God's purpose. So as you go through the week, listen to the sounds around you and see if you can hear where God might be making noises in your world. And especially if you hear God calling you, even in a whisper. Let's pray. Open our ears, God. Help us to listen for where you are in our lives and in our world. Amen. You know, there's a lot going on this week and a lot of places where we could sure stand to hear more from God. As the United Church of Christ, I'm sure you know that our motto is, God is still speaking. And whenever you see that in print or on a banner, there's a comma at the end. It's not a period. It's a comma, because God is always, continually speaking, and there's no end to God's voice in sight. We are in ministry, and our ministry is never ending. We have found some creative ways as the new year begins. We've got the peanut butter. It's getting to be pretty high stacked out there in the gathering area. We would love to see more. We are going to do the Penny Sunday. Again, another chance to reach out and spread God's kingdom and amplify God's voice in the world. We enjoy and appreciate having you on board with us. So again, as you know by now, if you've been watching, on our website, there's a green box over here that says Donate Now. The instructions, the prompts are very simple and easy to follow. Or if you prefer, you can drop something off at the church or mail it to the church to Strongsville UCC, 13740 Pearl Road, Strongsville, Ohio, 44135. However you are able to help us and to move God's ministry and speak God's word into a world in desperate need, we are grateful for you. Thank you.
it's okay. The last thing I need is to be heard, but to hear what you would say. Word of God, speak. Would you pour down like rain, washing my
passages. Now, as you probably know, before entering seminary, I spent 18 years teaching young children. Leaving children behind was one of the hardest things I had to do when I finally allowed God to begin to use me in a new way. At one point, in fact, I was really struggling with walking away from teaching. My heart was breaking. One afternoon, I took a long walk around Lakewood Park and walked down that winding ramp to the break wall along the edge of the lake. Along the path, there are benches where you can sit and listen to the waves splashing against the break wall and rest. There's this one particular bench, my bench. As I sat facing the lake, my eyes rested on a young sapling. My tree. I have no idea what kind of tree it was, but it was young and flexible, and this amazing thing always happened when I sat down on my bench. My little sapling would begin to quiver and quake, its leaves shaking in the breeze. But here's the thing, most days there was no breeze. None of the other trees along the lake shore would quiver and quake quite like my tree. I came to believe it was God's Holy Spirit, glad to see me, that set those leaves in motion. You can tell this is a hard story for me to tell. On this day, as I sat there watching the leaves dance, I began to feel tears begin to slide down my cheek. "It's not fair, God," I said out loud. "It's not fair that you're calling me away from these children. I need children in my life, and they need me. It's not fair." I sat there all alone, and I let the tears fall. The tree slowed its dancing, and then I heard it, clear as a bell, this voice, unlike anything I had ever heard before or since, whispered right in my soul. "My child," it said, "there will always be children in your life. Always." Then, as if out of nowhere, they appeared. A young man and his little daughter came strolling down from one direction, and three boys on bicycles laughing and shouting at one another from the other way. The path, which had been empty and still, was now teeming with young life. It was as if God was saying, "I told you so." And you know what? God's promise has never failed. I have some of the most amazing children in my life, my grandchildren, and especially here in my church family, and I am continually grateful. So, when I saw this week's passage about the young boy Samuel, my heart leapt. A child, it's a story about a child. The year is finally off to a good start. So let me tell you a little bit about what's going on before today's reading, so it'll make more sense. A Hebrew woman named Hannah was married to a man, Elkanah, who loved her deeply. But Hannah was barren and was unable to give Elkanah children. Day after day, Hannah would go to the temple and pray to the Lord that she would be able to have a child. Impressed by her faithfulness, the Lord heard her prayers, and Hannah became pregnant, giving birth to a son. She named her son Samuel and dedicated him to the Lord. Samuel served at Shiloh, mentored by a priest named Eli. Meanwhile, where we pick up the story, Eli has grown old in years. He has been serving at Shiloh for a very long time. Eli has two sons, Hophni and Phinehas, who saw being priests as a privilege rather than an opportunity to serve the Lord. They helped themselves to the best parts of the offering, the good parts of meat meant for the Lord, and they abused the women who served at the entrance to the tent of meeting. The Lord is not pleased, and he prepares to prophesy against the family of Eli. Listen to how this came about. I will be reading from Eugene Peterson's The Message. The boy Samuel was serving God under Eli's direction. This was at a time when the revelation of God was rarely heard or seen. One night, Eli was sound asleep. His eyesight was very bad. He could hardly see. It was well before dawn. The sanctuary lamp was still burning. Samuel was still in bed in the temple of God, where the chest of God rested. Then God called out, "Samuel! Samuel!" Samuel answered, "Yes, I'm here." Then he ran to Eli, saying, "I heard you call. Here I am." Eli said, "I didn't call you. Go back to bed." And so he did. God called again, "Samuel! Samuel!" Samuel got up again and went to Eli. "I heard you call. Here I am." And again, Eli said, "Son, I didn't call you. Go back to bed." This knew God for himself. It was before the revelation of God had been given to him personally. God called again, "Samuel!" The third time. Yet again, Samuel got up and went to Eli. "Yes, I heard you call me. Here I am." That's when it dawned on Eli that it was God calling the boy. So Eli directed Samuel, "Go back and lie down. If the voice calls again, say, 'Speak, God, I'm your servant, ready to listen.'" Samuel returned to his bed. Then God came and stood before him exactly as before and called out, "Samuel, Samuel." Samuel answered, "Speak, I am your servant, ready to listen." And the Lord said to Samuel, "See, I am about to do something in Israel that will make the ears of everyone who hears about it tingle." There's an awful lot of humanity on display in this passage. Sometimes I think we get it in our minds that maybe we aren't good enough for God to use, or we convince ourselves that God only speaks to other people, or even that times have gotten so bad that God has stopped speaking altogether. But as I reminded you, our denomination, the United Church of Christ, believes that God is still speaking today, tomorrow, and forever. So let's look more closely at what's going on here and what it means for us today on our journey as followers of the Christ. Now, throughout the first book of Samuel, faithfulness is on display. The woman Hannah, who so desired a child that she went up to the temple every day, staying for hours at a time, praying with everything she had. At one point, Eli sees her sitting in the silence, watches her lips moving as she prays. He approaches her and suggests that she has had too much to drink. She's drunk and should go home to her husband. Even this accusation did not deter her faithful prayer. And after her prayers were answered and Samuel was born, she did not allow her heart to become hardened or cynical against this priest Eli who had so insulted her. No, she still trusted that even in Eli's brokenness, God would use this tired, blind priest for God's good purpose. She committed her son for life to the service of the Lord, doubly important in light of the fact that Eli's own children were corrupt and had betrayed their vows as priests. So far in this story, God has chosen to use a woman, an old man, and a child to show God at work in the world. Three people who in the eyes of the world might be seen as unworthy or imperfect, but who have things in common. Eli has dedicated his entire life to serving God, yet even as his eyesight fails and he grows complacent in his position as priest, he remains available to the Lord. Hannah dedicates herself to a life of prayer, asking God for a child because she believes in the strength and power of the Lord and trusts that God will provide. When God finally answers her prayer, Hannah responds by dedicating her child, the gift from God for which she had prayed so very hard, to a lifetime serving in the temple. And Samuel, her son, well, like his mother, he was an obedient servant. He just wasn't aware at first who he was being called to serve. Sometimes at night, when we're really tired, our minds can be confused. We might think we are hearing one thing when in fact it's something completely different. When Samuel heard a voice calling him in the darkness, he assumed logically that it was his mentor and master, Eli. After all, Eli was old, his vision was failing, and his body was likely giving out as well. So it made perfect sense for Samuel to rush to Eli's room. "Hineni," he said, "here I am. Your eyes may be failing, and maybe you cannot see me, but here I am. Three times this scenario repeats itself. Eli patiently sends Samuel back to bed until the third time, when it dawns on Eli that it is God calling the boy. Perhaps it is God who is calling out, "He made me, here I am. Your eyes are not yet used to looking for me, but you have other ways of seeing me." When Eli realizes that it's God calling Samuel, he does indeed suggest to Samuel that his task at this point is not to stand before the Lord and announce his presence, but rather to kneel or bow before God's holiness and listen. When the voice calls out a fourth time, Samuel does as his mentor instructed. In the quiet of his room, he responds, "Speak, I am your servant, ready to listen." And boy, oh boy, does he get an earful. Our passage today ends here, but if you would like to continue and read the message God had for Samuel to deliver to Eli and his family, you can find it in the first book of Samuel, which is in the Old Testament, right after Joshua, Judges, and Ruth. Perhaps, like Samuel, your ears have been tickled and you will want to read the rest of the story. But for today, the rest of the story is this. God does not always use the powerful and mighty, even those who seem to hold authority in the church. There are many people who claim to have God's ear and wield the scriptures authoritatively, even while turning Christ's words literally upside down to serve their own purposes. There are those who, like Hophni and Phinehas, believe their position and station in life have given them license to do as they please, that they are somehow above the law. There are those who believe that might makes right and will beat or maim or worse anyone who tries to suggest otherwise. You know this simply is not the way of the Christ. Know and understand and believe. Human law may seem insufficient to rein them in at times, but no one, neither those who wield power nor those who wield guns, not those who rage angrily and spout lie after lie after lie, claiming to own God's truth while trampling over the least, the last, and the lost, not princes nor politicians nor presidents are exempt from God's law. For just such times as this, has God called you, child of God, to speak truth to light? God is still speaking. God is still at work in our world. And God is still choosing folks who may not yet truly know the Lord and who struggle to discern God's voice. Here's a newsflash. That is all of us. The human voices around us are particularly noisy these days, aren't they? Some things we're in control of: the television, the news radio, the internet. Temper your need to know with your desire to remain sane and watch less. Listen more to the beauty that surrounds us all, and especially listen for the whispers of hope and justice and peace that God is offering into your heart each day.
Thank you.
Amen. Let's sing together. Won't you join us? Take my life and let it be. Amen. Go in peace.